I'm Dr. Anthony Pick. I'm one of the endocrinologists with Northwestern Medicine. I'm working at Lake Forest Hospital, and I've been given this opportunity to talk about a subtype of diabetes called LADA, L-A-D-A, that I wanted to take this opportunity to educate folks about. And the reason for it is a famous singer, Lance Bass, who's with the InSick band, has recently been discussing and disclosed his diagnosis, information that he's shared with the community, and I think it'd be a nice opportunity to explain his diagnosis and what it may mean for other folks. So with that background, we generally divide diabetes into two major categories, so-called type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. And LADA, I'll talk about and explain in more detail in a moment. Now, with that preamble, what I think has been confusing is this entity called LADA, latent autoimmune diabetes. And the reason is because it can sometimes have features of type 1 and type 2 diabetes, like we just mentioned. But a key distinction here is that patients with LADA, actually, one of the criteria to diagnosis, have antibodies against their pancreas, the most common being one called the anti-GAD antibody, and there are others. So it turns out that it has features like type 1 diabetes, where the immune system is damaging or destroying beta cells, so decreasing insulin production, but it's much slower than you usually would typically see with type 1 diabetes. And another important feature of this is that many times people are diagnosed or misdiagnosed with type 2 diabetes, and over time it becomes apparent that they have this LADA type. And some of the clues, by definition, it has to be adults over age 30, and they tend not to be overweight. They tend to be normal body weight. Now, one of the challenges is overlap, is given that so many people are struggling with gaining weight, being overweight or obese, there's nothing stopping folks with type 1 diabetes or LADA being overweight, so you can get overlap. But one of the key concepts with diagnosing folks with LADA is not everybody gets pigeonholed in type 1 and type 2. You don't want to cause confusion because some people talk about, well, it's not 1, it's 2, as features of both, it's 1.5, and that causes confusion. But if you go back to the concept of latent type 1 or latent autoimmune diabetes, you have antibodies against the pancreas as a marker of immunity. And then what happens is that these folks over time get progression of the disease where they lose insulin production. It gets harder to control the glucose, and they may need over time need insulin therapy. And that's why pulling this out as a distinct subtype is important. Now, the type 2 diabetes is heterogeneous, the different subtypes. Type 1, as I mentioned, you're not immune for folks being insulin resistant, overweight. But I think this is just an opportunity for people to understand, the subtleties of diabetes. Now, in terms of all of that, I think regardless of whether you have LADA diabetes, type 1 or type 2, the goals have overlap. We want glucose control. We want a healthy lifestyle. We want to detect and prevent complications and manage them if they're present. But another goal with LADA diabetes is to actually preserve the beta cell function as best we can. So one of the tools we use is a blood test called a C-peptide. So it turns out when our bodies make insulin, it creates a bigger molecule called proinsulin, and then there's an enzyme that cleaves off the insulin. You can think about the C-peptide as a scaffolding for its release, kind of like a, let's say a rocket on its platform. It kind of, the platform falls away, the rocket goes up. Anyway, not that that's helpful, but the point being is that every time the body makes insulin, it makes C-peptide, and that can be a measure of insulin production. So in the world of LADA, we divide folks who are very low in C-peptide and very insulin deficient. They probably need insulin therapy sooner rather than later. One of the definitions of LADA is that you don't need insulin within 6 months of diagnosis. So one of the features is that there's still insulin production. And then the more the C-peptide is produced, the more you can use the medications we use for type 2 diabetes, although they don't have type 2 diabetes, they have LADA. And I think that's one of the things that Mr. Bass wanted to share is his journey in terms of, raising awareness about different types of diabetes. And in terms of the LADA, I believe looking at these photographs, he's not overweight. I think he's age 45. That's public knowledge as well. He had features to suggest that he wasn't typical for type 2 diabetes, Therefore, be on the lookout for LADR, like checking the antibodies, and then bearing in mind that his disease may progress more rapidly than typical type 2 diabetes. One last comment related to this is that it also informs the choice of therapies that we have. Now, LADR being a little more unusual, although it could certainly be maybe up to 12% of folks who label type 2 diabetes may have LADR, so it's not uncommon, but it becomes judgment of the clinicians involved in terms of choice of therapy. What I mean by that is that there's an old-fashioned family of diabetes medicines called sulfonylureas, very typically used in type 2 diabetes, but they actually accelerate the loss of beta cell function, the ability of the individual to make insulin, so they're actually considered a bad choice. And that can also cause low glucose at the wrong time and weight gain. So if you're trying to select drugs that are more beneficial, we want in that goal of preserving beta cells, we may look to these newer drugs. One family is called DPP-4 inhibitors. Sitagliptin is widely used in type 2. There's awareness now of the family medicines called GLP-1s that are widely used for type 2. Importantly, they may have some beta cell preserving properties. And all of them being equal, even if you know that patients have LADR and they may progress over time and have antibodies against their pancreas, obviously it'd be better to try and avoid or limit insulin use until it becomes absolutely necessary. So these medications may be insulin sparing. And having said that, if the LADR does progress to where the sugars are or the glucose levels are not well controlled, then we know that we need to use insulin, which is, you know, we try and avoid that even more so in type 2 diabetes. So this idea of sort of knowledge is power. And again, it goes back to the public service of Mr. Bass sharing his experience as an opportunity to educate the community about what I think is, you know, fairly subtle, but hopefully I've made it clear in terms of one, two, this latter state that has features of one and two, not to confuse with in between one and a half, but in terms of understanding that disease state a little better. That whether folks have type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, other atypical forms of diabetes, we didn't mention there's genetic forms of diabetes we call MODY, maturity onset diabetes of the young, or LADR itself, the foundation's the same, a very healthy lifestyle. The glucose control is important, but we either look at other parameters like blood pressure and cholesterol in terms of treating those and preventing complications like heart disease down the road. So I think another important concept in terms of diabetes, apart from, you know, classifying it correctly and sort of taking a deeper dive into the mechanism, what's going on, is being mindful of using all the appropriate tools to prevent the bad things that can be associated with diabetes. And they very much are preventable and treatable, but it requires a healthy lifestyle looking beyond glucose as well. So I think that's an important concept to share as well. So I just wanted to end by thanking Lance Bass for sharing his experience. And this is a springboard to educate the community around the subtleties related to diabetes.